And some of the biggest American companies also taking action. JP Morgan, Citigroup are suspending all political donations after the Capitol riots. Meanwhile, Marriott and BlueCross BlueShield are halting donations to Republicans who voted against certifying Joe Biden's election victory. Christine Romans joins us now with more. Business backing away, Christine, yeah. Finally recognizing that they have to put their money where their mouths and their views are on what their customers feel too.
This is the final good and true breakup, I think, of business with its business president, right? I mean, in the very beginning, there was optimism that they were going to be able to get, you know, some policies that they'd really enjoy, like tax cuts. They loved the tax cuts corporate America did. They didn't love the president's tariffs. They didn't love his tone. And now some of these companies with pretty sharp words are backing away from Republican lawmakers in particular, Blue Cross Blue Shield in its statement saying that they will suspend contributions to those lawmakers who voted to, quote, undermine our democracy. So one after another, companies are coming out with their statements for how they're going to handle this. And I can tell you, companies you haven't heard from yet, their executive teams are huddled together trying to decide what is the appropriate response for these companies, not only for their customers, but their employees, who are very, very concerned about the kind of America that their companies are doing business in at the moment. So a really remarkable turn of events, I think, here. In the very early going, 4 years ago, corporate America was hopeful that this president's deregulation tax cuts would be good for their business, but overall it's tone and the actions of Republican lawmakers and the president in the end that have caused a well and true breakup of corporate America and this administration.
Yeah, it's early days, and the skeptic in me, Christine, says it's early days in terms of elections as well, whether it's the midterms or 2024, and business isn't half pragmatic in a moment. It reacts very quickly and then suddenly it forgets what it needs to do or should be doing when business interests actually require them to give money in certain places in order to get the action that they want. How sustainable do we think these restrictions are? Because you can't separate politics from money in the United States. In order to win elections of any form, you've got to have financial backing.
So far, it's either a quarter or 6 months is what I'm seeing most of these companies are committing to. And some of them are committing to no political action committee contributions at all for the next 6 months, to let the new administration take hold and to try to let the temperature cool in this country. But you're absolutely right. There is always pressure from corporate America and from Washington. These two, money and politics, money is the oxygen in American politics. I do think there's something else at play here, the Lincoln Project, which you've probably heard of, and others who are going to be, and they have said so, they will be shaming companies who are putting money toward Congress members who they think are trying to undermine democracy. So I think you're going to start to see, you're going to see the temperature rise in terms of the PR pressure on some of these companies who are giving money to some of these lawmakers who voted not to certify a fair election in the United States. And many of these companies see that as just undermining democracy. By the way, rule of law and democracy is why this is such a great place to do business, right? That's what makes America America. So that's concerning to these companies.
Newly elected Republican member of Congress Peter Meyer writes this over the weekend: unless my party faces the truth of what happened and holds those responsible to account, we will never regain the public's trust and earn the honor of leading the nation forward. Do you agree with him? And if you do, what is holding them to account? Does it mean expelling, Senators Hawley and Cruz? That's been discussed. What is accountability for them?
Well, I'm glad to see that the political marketplace is working out there with organizations, companies, individuals saying we're simply not giving any more contributions to those who held up the election or tried to hold up or overturn the election. So that certainly has to happen. But those who were in leadership positions, in particular in the House and Senate, who went along with the president's falsehoods, ought to face consequences in terms of their own reelection and obviously immediately in terms of leadership positions that they might hold. So I hope the party has a reckoning here. I do feel, and I've said this for a couple of years now after various events, thinking this will finally wake some of my colleagues up as to who this man is and what we're doing to the party. I do feel that the events of last week have accelerated, hopefully, the march away from not just the president, but away from Trumpism as well.
You do? Even though six senators and 138 members of the House still went back in that building in the middle of the night and refused to accept the results of the election?
Oh, I think that that's an awful thing. But I do think, as a whole, the population of Republicans, now, there are the subset of a subset of a subset who vote in Republican primaries, and that's what a lot of Republicans respond to with their inability to get away from the president. But the broader population, though, I think saw the events of last week and said, you know, we can't go there. We've got to move away from the president. Obviously, the president is going to be gone. He'll be removed from the scene. I think that his influence will diminish. I thought it would before this event. Just when you lose the trappings of office and the levers of power, and Trumpism requires some kind of swagger of winning, which we haven't. We've, as Republicans, lost the House of Representatives in the midterms. We just lost control of the Senate. Mm-hmm. We've lost hundreds of legislative seats in state legislatures nationwide. So we've got to move ahead and move away from the president. And I get the feeling, and I had an experience just yesterday where one of my longtime supporters who had supported many of my campaigns during the past couple of years has been very critical of where I've been and very supportive of the president, approached me and said, that's it, I'm done. Mm. Mm. And then, so I you know, that's anecdotal. There's still a lot of support for the president and his positions, but I do feel that last week was an event that will move people away.
Let's end on this, because I will always remember what you said in 2018. It's when you sat down with 60 Minutes and you were leaving office. And here's what you said.
There's no value to reaching across the aisle. There's no currency for that anymore. There's no incentive.
There is no value, no political value to reaching across the aisle. Senator Flake, that was in 2018. If that was then, what about now? Is it just worse now?
Well, now one difference we'll have in 11 days' time is a president who models better behavior in that regard. Joe Biden was in the Senate for 36 years. He knows how to reach across the aisle. And you have a lot of my colleagues, former colleagues, who want to legislate, who actually want to do what they were elected to do, and have been tired of, frankly, just approving the president's executive agenda, judges, and they want to legislate. So I do think it will change, but that has been the case over the past couple of years. Yeah. It used to get you plaudits by saying, I reach across the aisle and I'm bipartisan. Now it just gets you a primary. That's been the case over the past year, but I do think that that's going to change.
Let's hope it does. Former Senator Jeff Flake, thank you very much.